everybody, and welcome back to another episode of ZBrush Masters. So this is season four. So give a shout out if you can see me and Maria here today. So we're going to go through and Maria's going to show us some awesome stuff inside of ZBrush. So I have Maria Panfilova here today with us, and she's an amazing, amazing ZBrush artist. So definitely one of the ZBrush Masters for sure. And I got to see some of her techniques and stuff at the summit, the ZBrush Summit last year. She was doing some classes for us. So we had a few attendees that were able to go in and get a 4-hour lesson with her. And she went through all her kind of techniques and stuff. So really, 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 really awesome. And so just give a shout out if you can see us in the chat here. This is going to be live. So if you have any questions, I'll kind of be moderating. So if you have anything that pertains to what she's kind of showing, I'll ask them to her, and then she can kind of go into those and hopefully get some of those answers for you. So do you have anything else, Maria, you want to hit on before you start, before I give you the screen?
I'm ready to share a screen.
You're ready? All right.
thank you very much, Joseph. Pleasure to be here. And thank you guys for coming on this stream. We will discuss plenty of things. Compositions, pose, body, references, something about creatures and about my pipeline. And I will be explaining some things on examples of these two works. This one is finished and this one I'm doing right now. And I think it will be fun that something that in the progress and my thoughts about it are fresh. So I'm excited to share them with you. First of all, I wanted to share with you some of my recent inspirations that I stumbled upon. So these artists are from older years, and but to me, they look like fantasy. A lot of fantasy in here. And when I saw that, I was very inspired. First one is Gustav Dor. You can see that it's 19th century, and he's well known for illustrations for Divine Comedy. And I just really love his stuff, what compositions he have. And I like it so much so that I can take one guy from here and start to sculpt it. I like it very much. And I have a sweet spot for graphic illustrations, and they're very good fit for the sculpt, in tandem with sculpt. Next one is Henry Justice Ford, and this guy is he was drawing even before Tolkien was born, so you can imagine that fantasy was existing way before we think, and there's a lot of fairy tale stuff, and a lot of it quite dark. And now looking at it, it looks quite fresh because it was forgotten by new generation, and we can see it as a fresh eye now. And I encourage you to, if you're looking for a style and if you're looking for new subjects to explore, try to find in old ages artists who you like. And there are very well-known eras and artists like Renaissance and Frazetta, which everybody knows and inspired. But there's some very cool deep corners that you can go to and be amazed what you can find. Another one is Virgil Finale, and just love the compositions for illustrations that they made. Simon Beasley is a more late one, comic artist, and he have a very, very cool Bible theme stuff that very inspiring to me. And also Arthur Rackman. So talking about this work that I made recently, it started from a quite old work that I noticed by Fritz Anger. And I was really amazed to see this contrast between and what shape he have and she, and how she is shining on the background of the guy. So my work is basically started from this one. And talking about composition, I want you to introduce you to my approach that I like is a big shape is simple approach. So when you're planning your composition and your character, I tend to do shapes, big shapes simplified. So you can fit everything into very simple shape. And of course you can have details, but all of this, all the complexity, you can describe by a simpler shape. And I think this way, when you do is readability grows and appealing grows when you do that. Of course, it's not the only way, but this one I personally find really attractive. Again, this quite complicated anatomy, but in a simple way from the distance. And in some of my work, you can see that I try to use that and do the complexity and combine it into an order. So this one is by Paul Bonner, and this artist is famous by doing that. He does a lot of details and a lot of cool stuff, but it's all inside a big round shape, and you can see even how beard and face and then closing goes into the same line. So here I even try to not only do character, but also some postament within a same line, and it gives a movement, and the sword will be a opposite one, and we see a triangular shape as a result. So simplicity is what makes your work on a big silhouette is what really helps to make work more appealing. And we can, it's not something that artists invent. You can see it in life as well. And photographers also try to do that when they make their compositions. So again, her clothing and her hairstyle and how she put her legs together helps to achieve this simple look and get inside of her, and really helps with the appeal of the image. So when I started work, I tried to approach it, and I draw his body in a simple way. And then I started in ZBrush and also followed this approach. Then I went to Photoshop, and my idea was to make him more square shape. So we will by this we will see the difference between his character and her. He is quite simple, square, and rough, and simple-minded, I would say. And she is more flowy, and a lot of shape of her gives this water feel. And by that we see how different they are, and how difficult for him to keep her in hands because she's flowing from him. I can show some stages in ZBrush.
Yeah, I think that'd be good. Now, for your process too, when you're doing this, is this kind of your, like when you approach a piece of your own work, is this like your entire thought process? Do you repeat the same thing like all the time, like looking for reference from say like old masters, and then going in and breaking it down to the simple shapes? and then doing your kind of blockouts like you just showed?
No, I don't think so. I think it's what's on the top of my mind at the present moment. So this artist that I shown, I found just a few months ago. And before that, there was some different artist, or maybe it was more modern artist. So it all depends on what I want to approach in a new work. Sometimes this very work is focused on study, and I don't go far to artistic side, and I focused on anatomy or something else. So it may depends very much.
Now, how many hours a day do you usually spend sculpting in ZBrush? Like, if you had to put a number on it?
Because I work, it's pretty much. So if it's a usual day, it's like 8 hour day long we work. Mm-hmm. And sometimes I work after, sometimes not. Sometimes I work in weekend. It depends very much because when you're a freelancer, your schedule is varies very, very much from 1 month to another. Mm-hmm. There are some months that I have no work and I only do personal stuff, and some months where I have way too much freelance and I have no free time. So there is no rule. But because I combine work and try to do personal work at the same time, it's as a result, it's very a lot of hours in ZBrush. So if I see the early stage, it was overwhelming to start and too much stuff. But you can see how I have a lot of questions about pose, and do I pose in symmetry or asymmetrical from the start, or do I use mannequin? So in this, it also depends very much in the case. But in this time, my idea was his pose is quite symmetrical from the beginning. So a lot of time you can spend sculpting with symmetry. And his legs, they're very close to symmetry in the end, so the majority of time I kept it them symmetrical. And they're isolated from the body for the convenience. And in case of his body, because his arms are very, very different and have very different pose, I started them asymmetrically because there's no use to make them symmetric from the beginning. And same thing with girl. There's no, I see no reason to do her symmetrically because it's important to start sometimes with a pose so you understand what's going on and what will be as a result. But what I do try to keep is to keep the head symmetric as much as I can. And for giant, it was quite easy. And everything is around his face, basically. And for girl, it was a bit more trickier. But if you see it closely, now the head is in the middle stage, is detached from the body. And I can isolate it, rotate it. And if we... It usually have a polygroup, so this area is on a polygroup. And we can turn on Y symmetry, switch from X to Y, and turn on local symmetry. And despite his horizontal and doesn't look that, we can do it, but we can. If we keep everything isolated and turn on local symmetry and change the axis.
Now, all your models, when you sculpt them like this too, like you, the earlier things with your giant, he had all his segments kind of broken off. So usually keep stuff separated so you can easily pose it and move it around, things like that.
Yeah, I like it very much when you can, if we go to earlier again, when you can just hit solo and isolate it, and it's very, very fast. And I have a hotkey for solo, so I do it quicker.
Mm-hmm. Now we have some questions about your anatomy stuff. And did you, you know, go to school for studying anatomy? Have you just picked this up on your own? You mentioned doing a lot of studies. So what was kind of like your, have you always done this as an artist?
I predicted questions about anatomy, so I have a few advices and suggestions.
Excellent.
So I did a lot of different things. I watched a lot of video courses, and but I want to focus on two things that I may suggest to you if you want to upgrade your knowledge in anatomy, and I personally did that as well. So a first approach is making écorché that I made a few times, and I made it for animal and human. And this one is not finished, but it's the most recent one. So how I did that, not just making it by using references, it's not enough. You need to have some educational source to follow. And I think the proco.com is a very good one. The course is called Anatomy of the Human Body for Artists. And don't think that it's only for 2D artists. Because if you go to the course, you will see that it have a lot of stuff inside. For example, about if we see the torso, and we can see a part with video, a part with a list of all you need to know. And after that, you have this, which is very, very helpful. You can rotate it and see each individual muscle in isolation. And reference like that help you to build your anatomy model in ZBrush. So you won't have a lot of questions because everything is basically here. So yeah, I think it's better than just following books because it's this way is more entertaining and more from different sites. Video have a lot of information and plus this reference. And even more than muscles, I think it's important to build a skeleton and focus on joints because when you approach an actual project with sculpts, a joint part is where most mistake happens, and joints means also knowing of landmarks. And I think when you learn anatomy is one that you should be focusing first. Aside from écorché, what I can also recommend is to take big projects for yourself. Before I talked about art stuff, composition and inspiration, but this kind of project, this work was made by Daniel Pitil. This kind of project is more educational one. And the key thing that for project like that, you need to find a very, very good source of reference. Where the model is, you can judge from all angles and observe everything. But when you have this as a base, you can combine it with a project like that and try for real, on a real person, to implement what you learned doing anatomy, more raw anatomy version. So this anatomy reference was done by Scott Eaton, and he has a course himself, so you can check that out. You should expect that this takes time, a lot of time. So this work like that, you can put months in that, and that's totally normal, but you will have a lot of useful skills from that.
Excellent.
If I answered anatomy question, I can.
Yep, that was good. I was putting links in the chat for all the stuff you were talking about.
So yeah, before I made more educational works, I did stuff like that, but not every time I finished them. Sometimes it's just in my folder somewhere. And also sometimes worked by a concept when I wasn't sure what I want to do. Just take a concept and, or maybe take a head for sculpt, for likeness. Something educational is more, is I have less anxiety when I just start educational work, and it's a good thing to have balance between artworks and educational, and they are both good, have good and sides in each one. So we can slowly go to this work and show how I started them. So the initial idea was that the girl have no idea what behind. She is happy because she thinks that it's her friend, and he asked, guess who? So initially I made a sketch, which this kind of sketch only I understand. I made it just for myself and can go from it, and it answers a bit of composition questions to me. And from that, I go to stages. So this work I started from base mesh that I have. And base mesh is not perfect one. And from time to time, I go back to it and try to improve it. But doesn't matter really. Just helps to save some time at the beginning. And duplicated hands into future creature hands. In the next stage, I transferred these arms into Sculptris Pro and started to do the shape that I need. So with having Snake Hook and Sculptris Pro, you can very quickly make the shapes that you want. And here is a new subtool I created to start from it new base. So you can see that the creature from the beginning is divided to parts, and helps me a little bit handle it better and faster. So when I want to increase thickness, I turn on move and hit backface mask, which is in my interface, and quickly do the thickness like that. And then I can just decrease the size and smooth it and have more density.
Now, are you mostly using Sculptris Pro when you're in this design phase as well?
His face?
Sculptris Pro, are you using that in your design phase in this part?
In this design phase. Yeah, it's a nice one, and I really like to use it recently. And it has a very good reason to use compared to Dynamesh, because when you Dynamesh this arm, for example, you have this problem. So your arms are stitched, and before I had to keep this in mind if I had very close areas like that that I don't want to be stitched. And the Sculptris Pro, I don't worry about that, and I can go with that and even to here. There is a little problem when it's very dense, if I start to dig more and more details. And now I just want to select smoothly it, and for example, move it and change the length. And to do that, you need to have your smooth mask. And usually what you do with base mesh, it's very easy, because in a lower subdivision, it's very easy to select part and smooth. With Sculptris Pro, it's trickier, but I have one tip that you can do is when you go farther and farther and farther. So you scale down your mesh, and with Mask Lasso, you select your area And as a result, you will have a soft mask. And now you can do that more easily. If you scroll down even more, so like that, it will be even smoother. These tips, my friend Lisa recently recommended me, and it was really cool one because before that I selected gradients and did it like that. It takes a little bit more time, but the result is the same. The mask is smooth. So with a very dense geometry, you can still do this smooth masks. You can see that your body for now is symmetric, but I push it closer to what I imagine. And here I start to push density higher and to find the big shapes in his features. I tried to do it similar to anatomy features, so I keep in mind that there's an elbow and there will be a rich muscles here, and here will be a delta, but on the other hand I keep it, it's a creature, so I can push it really, really far. And in further versions, I make his arms really, really small, and this base is really big, and it's also, I think, a good way to do, because you have this flow that really nice looking, and his small hands make sense because she is supposed to think that it's her friend, not a monster.
We've had a few questions on when you're sculpting, how do you know, like when you're messing with the arm anatomy and stuff like that, when you're sculpting it, you can see something wrong and you go in and fix it. Is there any like techniques or tips you have for people for knowing when something's wrong? Like you talked about the joints being like one of the few things that people do and you can tell it's incorrect. Is this any tips or just basically just keep doing those écarchés and studying mm-hmm. your anatomy?
Yes, of course. And this is second thing that I was going to mention. On top of your anatomy studies, the second key thing that you need to do is a good observation of real models. And so it goes hand in hand, anatomy study and observing the reference. And I have, so there's some basic examples that help me, and poses like that for the girl. And this helps to see how the excited feel, cheerful feel can look like, and surprise. And like it's, I see it as an actor's that showing me how it's supposed to look like. And of course my pose can be a little bit different, but it tells me a lot, like where exactly should be your foot, where it placed when her leg is bent, what the curve of the spine can be in this pose. So there's a lot of little questions that I need to cover, and to do that I collect references. One another thing that you can do is make a photo by yourself, just sit in the same position and make photos from all angles. Even if you're a guy and do a girl, it's nothing bad if you do repeat, and it still will be very helpful because we are in a lot of ways where it's the same. We will have the same joints. Areas will be practically the same, and you can study it from yours. But in addition to Google Pictures, I go further and I collect more references. And very useful is to observe 3D scans. And I don't have scans. I have a bunch of scans that I got from a website, 3D Scan Store. And of course, there is no exact pose that I need, but I can select different parts of the body that I need and follow them. For example, this one is for only the bent elbow. And the interesting thing that I can show you, so she have it bended like that, and it's quite like the most way you can bend it is the maximum way. And if you just take reference and see it like that and see this shape, but actually it will be wrong because it's bended not enough. And in this way, it bends completely, almost completely. And you can see how the changes of the shape of elbow changes really, really much. It's the same person, but only she bent it a little more, and we see how ridge muscles of her popping up comparing to this, and we see how strongly we will see two landmarks of the body. This one will be elbow landmark, which goes here, and here's also landmark, and the second one will be lateral epicondyle, which goes to humerus bone here, and humerus bone at the top we'll also see. And this is the reason why we do this écorché, because after we did that, we have a skill to read the reference correctly and be able to break it down and get more information from it. So, on example of the girl, if we see, let's go to the last one. So it was elbows like that, and something was wrong here. And I observe reference a little more, and change it here. And I put this lateral epicondyle a little more. And here it will be an elbow, and here will be medial. And I put this ridge muscles more. So in this fix, I did a little progress from that to that. And we only discuss an elbow, and you can imagine how more of it you should be taken into consideration. There's a neck in a stage when she put her heads slightly upward. And again, before, in a previous version, I had a sternocleidomastoidus muscles, which was too strong and quite unnatural. And I took more, looked at it a bit more, and make it softer and combine them more with the rest of the neck. And it's a very common mistake people do when they protruding sternocleidomastoid muscles way too heavily. When for a young girl, it should be slightly more subtle. But when she moves her head up, it really can pop out. But you should be really, really careful to do that. It really helped me to go and render. I rendered it in Maya to check the mistakes like that, because in a new environment, you will see your work differently. And in this render that I, it's a test render in the middle that I made, the muscle look too symmetrical and too weird to me. So I decided to go back and fix it. So same thing with bent knee, and also it's not only technical stuff like what bones and what muscles and how it looks, but it's also quite the flowy stuff, the gestural and the beauty curves. You can see that if you observe reference. Here. Sculpture and scan, and in both ways you can see in this pose a very beauty curve goes from the knee to the tip of the toes, and same picture you see in the scans. And if you don't if you don't observe this stuff and do it by your how you imagine it, usually, typically, people would go by straight and symmetrical. It's what people tend to do, and if you not be aware all the time, you will always do this symmetric. And even the muscles that people tend to do, they put the bone quite in the middle and put this side and this side symmetrical, which is not the case. In reality, there's a lot of shifts. You will see this form will be a bit higher, this shape will be a bit lower, and it's on the curve. And two bony landmarks will be also in a different level, so we're avoiding symmetry as much as we can. And reference like that really reminds us all the time that you should be looking for asymmetry. And if we see how the knee look on the band, we see that it's a femur bone, but on one side, it's look rounder and bigger. And on the other side, it looks more square. It have more square form and smaller. So it all gives asymmetry to the shape. So same thing with a bent wrist. Let's take a look, and there's a lot of going on the wrist. And when I did it, I also look at my wrist, and it's easy to do, like very easy to get reference. And what I see here is here will be a small bone that is called pisiform. And I really like to pop it out and like to find it and do on my scalps. This is a bone from the elbow, which I already mentioned. And here will be some, I guess, muscles, not muscles, but tendons popping up a little when you bend it like that. And what's happening on the other side is also really important. So even if you do stylized figure and maybe not going too much detailed, I still prefer to do these landmarks and don't make it too even. When you do it, everything is too even. It's not looking organic. I see human body is a combination of sharp forms combining with soft forms. And in this way, it looks much more natural. So let's go back a little bit and see where I started asymmetry. So now she's asymmetric, and here she started to shift. And we can talk about composition again. So I keep in mind that the creature is triangular, and she's a triangular inside. And her pose, I try to fit in a triangular, and him as well. And for this reason, I create tentacles, so they help me to support the shape. And also for this reason, I made his head pointy. So pointy head also supports triangular shape. And now it's starting to look interesting to me from this boring, and now she's a bit wavy and playful, like a very cheerful girl. And but I still keep the at this stage the hand is still in symmetry, and the face also for a long time will be symmetric for up until the end. The t-shirt is quite nothing special. It's just put very quickly with standard brush, and alpha I put big strokes off. Folds. Yes, and going back to his arms, So you can see I made an indication of elbow and ridge muscles as a peak shape. And my intent to find in this, like I said, in this big shape, I try to find smaller shapes, but they should be in a balance with a big one. So inside of it, I try to find rhythm. So this shape will be the second big after this. This one will be the biggest. And some others will be already smaller. So I keep in mind that I'm not making two equally big shapes next to each other. I try to make one major, and this one will be secondary. And also try to give some direction to the shape itself. So not making, again, not making it symmetrical. Symmetrical will be not organic. Instead, I try to have a belly, one big belly for a shape, and it's stretched into the side and losing a volume. It's very common belly shape that you can see often in a lot of cases. The muscle will look like that, and the fat pads will look similar. So even when you invent shapes that not exist, I try to follow the same approach. On the next stage, I try to get even smaller and inside this big shape, make it a bit more complex and find a little bit smaller. My big inspiration for creatures is Simon Lee. Where's creatures? Creature. And I really love his approach to design and these things that I mentioned about hierarchy of big shapes to smaller shape. He nails it, and there's a lot to learn. So you can see he made this big shape, and inside I see it as a smaller shape. And small elements are grouping into this flow. So this all details, they are not random. They go in some direction. And from smaller to bigger is a very common pattern that you can use. So when I did, I tried to approach the same. And as this nice, I like that there's a very calm and even surfaces when you can do your anatomy and make it more closer to human. And suddenly there's something happening. And you can notice that it's on silhouette. And I also like to do that on silhouette, there's a small detail that popping up and make it, the silhouette is more interesting. So I put attention if these details are visible in silhouette, and I try to put it into the silhouette if I can. But overall, again, simple shape, if we combine it all together, it's still a very, very simple shape in the end. So this thing that I think about when I do the design, so I keep in mind that he should be still be quite simple overall and triangular shape, but inside I do a complexity with this hierarchy of element from bigger to smaller, and they're going inside each other, and try to find some lines that flows the my wrinkles as well. So wrinkles are also helping really much to follow shapes that I aim. And even the veins that you see here, like they're also a continuation of shapes going from here to here. So it's not random veins, and it's a veins with a direction that goes here. If we go a bit further with a creature, you can notice that this shape is a very popping up, and I intentionally made them on silhouette. And here's more and more details to it. And I can go to more technical and what the brushes can help you to achieve effects like that.
Yeah, I think that'd be great. So we had some questions too on your kind of social media and helping you do freelance stuff. Has that been like a big help in you finding like freelance work and, you know, showing your artwork off to the world? We had some questions about like, how did you find, you know, like being in Russia, how did you find, you know, work and stuff like that?
Yeah, I think social media is key when you're working, being in Russia and being a freelancer. And usually the industry works in a direction that clients approach artists and not the opposite way. And when artists try to approach a client, it usually doesn't work. And they're busy and they usually approach you when they need someone. So for this reason, these websites were like Upwork, it's called, I'm not sure. They're not really a good working scheme because in this way, artists approach client, and really better when client approach artist. And so to approach you, it can be two ways. Somebody recommended you or they found your work online, and it's really working. If you do what they need, they will definitely approach you. And recently, in last years, I had a lot of inquiries to make a dragon because I made dragons as a personal work, and they saw it. And so if I wanted, I could make a dragon all year long. I can just selectively take only dragon gigs and do only them. And same way with, for example, I studied Marvel's designer and made a work with Marvel's designer project. And suddenly clients who need exactly that started to approach me. And after that, I studied hand paint techniques, and then projects that need hand paint characters started to approach. So I see a big correlations between what exactly I do for myself at free time and what clients approach me for what work.
Another question for you too. So like when you're working on your models here, like how many parts is your model right now broken down into? Because I think we have a lot of questions about, well, how does she keep this separate or stop from fusing together? And you model in all these different pieces, so you have multiple sub tools, right, that make up this entire character.
Yes, but there's not that much pieces. This one is the same. Mm-hmm. And from the beginning it was like that. So one piece, second, and this on the side, and this on the base and his belly. And then I find ways to fuse them together visually. So it's not like I try to physically fuse, but just make sense that like they're together. But if you want to fuse them really, really strongly, and you don't want somebody notice the seam, you can do that. You can just put it here like that and hit the brush Z project and just go. It will be for a long time because I have a lot of video opening. I do that in a case, for example, when I have a body and I still want to keep my legs separate from the torso. And I just do it like that. In the end, when the sculpting is done, I just fuse the leg to the torso this way, and it works well. Instead of the project brush, you can just use traditional project. It works as well, but just selecting the area that you need and maybe using morph target. If I turn off everything, we can see the seam because it's one subtle, active subtle is lighter. But if I put the color, I can also project the color, I believe. Mm-hmm. But it can be check if there are layers.
Yeah, it's a good trick for fusing stuff together.
Yeah, the polypaint is working, and now we don't see any seams, but it's still a different subtool. And with Gyorn, because I started with base mesh, it's a single piece. It's, you know, sometimes it really helps because when I do the progress and I go the wrong way, for example, something I don't like in a new version, I can just go to old version, export it, not necessarily from the highest subdivision, it can be from the lowest, export it in a file, and go to next version. If the topology is the same, I can just import the old version and morph them together, like using morph target, and do that as well. So there's a very good pros if you keep your wireframe, not changing it. And that's why I quite early switched to Ziri Mesher, as you can notice. Let's see where I start to sculpt on Ziri Mesher. So this is, no, this is, yeah, it's Ziri Mesher. Yeah, it's Ziri Mesher. So at this stage, it was Sculptex Pro. Mm-hmm. No, it's not Sculptex Pro. This one was Sculptex Pro. And at this stage, I decided that the big shape is enough, and I'm happy with that, and I can switch to Ziri Mesher. And with having, no. It's Sculptex Pro still.
But you do shift your pipeline where you'll block in stuff with Sculptex Pro and then, you know, switch to Ziri Mesher and then use the traditional subdivisions to divide back up and add more detail.
Yeah. With Ziri Mesher, then what you can do, you do more clean, and I usually divide parts a bit into polygroups. I divide the fingers, for example, so growth selection, Control Shift X, and Control W to no. So now you can isolate it and work separately. So Ziri Mesher have a lot of good sides, but there's a downside. So if you want to change everything much, it will be harder with Ziri Mesher. Sometimes I have to Ziri Mesh again. So going back to creature details, so you have some stuff, and of course you can use alphas, and I use them, but I try to look for different ways to do that, because I like to have this direction, as I mentioned, and try to find ways that helps me with that direction. For example, what can I do is turn on snake hook, select alpha. I made this alpha, sometimes I use it for this reason, exact this reason, make alpha. And by that, you pushing quite specific shapes of small pimples. And you can even twist it. And if you have Sculptex Pro, it may be more interesting, even more interesting result. If we go back, let's try it here. So you can rebuild the wireframe. Another alpha that I can use here is spray, default spray alpha, and do the same way. And before doing that, I hit morph target. So anything that is too much, I will remove later. And with these details, I try to follow some direction and lead it into, so we have everything goes together here and going and twisting inside here. So all these details that I do, I try to follow this big direction. And what I also did here is in between, I made ridges like that, and I divided with a Damien standard. and made it more complex. What also you can notice is these wrinkles, and it's sometimes it's on inside my head, and I because I saw it somewhere before and did that before. But some things are I just observing how other sculptors did that, and like I like this how he did this, and it's clay, but I trying to figure out how to make it in ZBrush. So around big shape, I split it by these wrinkles around, and I can smooth it later. But after smoothing, I will have an organic look. And when I see it's too flat, I go with inflate, because trying to avoid flat surfaces for organic, especially with this girl's monsters, inflated balloons will be really good looking. We can see this at tentacles. So the shape of the tentacles is the first thing. If you do something like that, try not to do it too simple shape on a cross section. If you do a cross section and see how it looks like, and it's not supposed to be a even circle. I try to break down the shape to have some muscles inside, like it's something like muscles. And also important thing that it's on the lying on the floor, and it should be interacting with the floor and get the witness will get bigger near the floor. So I try to give the feel that it's lying and it have weight. Good reference for that I found for a tentacle by Koju Tajima. And you can see these details and can go with it and try to do something like that. And you can notice that the more wrinkles will appear where it's squished. So everything is grabbed together here, so I make more wrinkles here, and I make very even surface with less wrinkles here, and here again more wrinkles. And another thing important is not to make them parallel. So if you look at it, it will be hard to find parallel, even if we can think it's parallel, but actually it's not. It will be a bit narrowing down here and there. And it also will be like a belly and the tendon, like if we compare it with muscle. So it will be a more full side and it's narrowing down. And same thing with closing folds, with everything.
I usually find that if you have a pet octopus too, it works pretty well for reference.
Octopus would be really great. I only had crabs in my aquarium, but they fight with each other all the time. And eventually, only one crab remained alive, like the strongest one. For a long time, I had only one crab, the strongest.
So while you're looking at the tentacle there, we had some questions about the skirt, too, since you just mentioned the clothing. We had some questions about how you did the skirt.
Let's go back a little bit. So at first time I tried to figure out what kind of skirt I want. And I figured that this kind is more interesting visually. And find, of course, for everything, looking for reference that helps you to see the shape and in this particular pose how the skirt would look like. And with this kind of skirt, it's also have some composition purpose, you can say. Like I try to make a directional line even there, like how this flowing into the skirt and how skirt flowing here back. So I try to combine everything together. Yeah, but technically it was, so first I build it basic shape with slash 2 brush and I make a big false like that. And it will be overlapping, so I may select lasso and put it that. And it's not like I'm not doing it as a clean version. I'm doing it like figure out if I like it. And at first, I want to decide if I keep this design skirt or I should look for something else. That's why at first I try to use very draft tools to do that. And then I decided that I'm happy with that. And this version is already a low poly. And just with hand with topology, I figured I started with zero measure. And it it gave me relatively clean wireframe, but I wanted it to be more cleaner. So I started to edit zero measure to have a cleaner result. And with a cleaner result, I can select individual loops, and sometimes it helps really much and with between folds. So in this case, I guess in the whole work, that's the only example when I really wanted to have a clean wireframe. So the belt is separate, and thank you guys that you added thickness in dynamic regions. I love it so much. So you have, usually with clothing, I go to the body, select one loop, duplicate subtool, invert, delete higher subdivisions. To do that, I remove layers. Invert, and here is my future belt shape. And then I can go to dynamic subdivisions, turn on dynamic, and you will see that it will be shrinking. To avoid that, I go to my menu that I have quiz. This quiz will be, let's find quiz in geometry palette. Just hit quiz with eight, maximum degree will be fine, and it will give a crease to borders. So now it won't be shrinking when you dynamically subdivide it. And then you hit thickness to some value. And now you can work with the shape. When you just duplicate it, it can be a problem that it's a bit wobbly and you don't want that. So to fix it quickly, I go to deformation and polish by features. And just do that. And it's a pretty simple one, but even with more complex one, when you already have thickness and more details, if everything is creased and divided by polygroups, it's very handy to use polish by features to make even shape very, very quickly. And again, thickness is here. Maybe we don't need this smooth. Sometimes I don't need, so I just turn it to zero. And to quickly adjust the shape segments, I hit to zero. I don't need segments. To quickly increase the thickness, just it depends on situation, but just can select everything by lasso and increase. You can notice that I sometimes switching between clip and mask brushes by hotkey. So I put control and whatever key to one mask and to another and to the third, and I can really quickly switch in between. And same thing with clipping. It only only ask if you are you sure you want to do that. do you know, Joseph, is there any way to turn it off?
So only if it has an option on that says ignore this until the next ZBrush we start.
I wonder if there are some macros that do this, turn it off each time.
You could set a macro to auto skip it. Yeah, but it would just apply the button press basically.
Yeah, I need that.
I can probably get something together for you.
Oh, that was great. And with a skirt, same thing. So dynamic adds thickness, and with that I have more understanding how it will look like in the end, and I made a proper distance between segments, so this will be probably need to adjust it a little. Like that. And again, turn it and see if I need to tweak it further. So we get back to the tentacles.
Here, I got two more questions for you, quick ones. So we have one question on how, like, what is your end goal for these models you do? Like, say this is a freelance project. You usually end up going for, like, concept art only? Is it ever going to 3D print? Like, what are your freelance kind of jobs, the final end result entail?
It depends on what client asks me. Mm-hmm. So it can be different cases. It can be, for example, if it's a mini, it's supposed to be a miniature, then it's a small case, small scale. It means that the details won't be as refined as on a big scale. So small scale, I try to do really quick and put as little time as I can, and tweet it with like be careful about small details and maybe make it bigger for a miniature scale. For a big sculpture scale, I go much more further, and if we see the end result. Like, it's not an end still, but for a large scale, it's definitely not enough. And I will be refining it more and more until everything is, until I'm happy with everything. But for a small scale, you can just skip some steps. But usually for freelance, I work more for animation and for games. So it's another case. It's usually characters with a symmetric pose and with topology and all that. And I was about to go to pipeline subject later, so we can go deeper into this subject.
Okay. Time frame for this model too, we had some questions. So for this one, now you've mentioned that you're not fully done with it yet, but what is usually your time frame from start to finish on a sculpture like this?
It's a hard question because because it's personal, I think it's not really healthy to make limits to yourself. Because when you do personal work, you are studying something, you learn something new, and you try to push the area which is not, you have no idea what is it, and you try to discover that, and nobody can tell how much time it will take you. And some works that I did were very smooth, and I could do the whole pipeline process for 3-4 days. Some of them was like that, but it's a minority of work. Mm-hmm. The majority of work, I have a lot of struggles and very unhappy on some stage, and trying to figure out why it's not working, trying to go back. So I not like how it looks on the render. I tried to go back and fix the sculpt. And so if it's tricky and challenging, it can go for longer. But as a general rule, I try to limit the time in a way to maybe not polish everything 100%. Mm-hmm. Because when you do render, like that, you can hide a lot of stuff, yeah, and not everything as much visible. And in ZBrush, we can scale it up and see that she's not perfect here and her hair is not perfect. But when we look like that, I troubleshooting from this view. So I get this view and I see, okay, this hair, I don't like them because they look very wobbly and very messy. So I check that I need to fix the hair. But something that I don't see, I just keep them and they're good enough. If we don't see it, then they're good enough. And then later, maybe someone wants to print it as a miniature, say, or as a... is a big statue. Then I can go back after I posted it. Then I come back and revisit it and for the purposes who want to do that and adapt the model and maybe push it a bit further if needed.
And then another one for you too. So we have a lot of questions in the chat about perspective, and do you always sculpt in perspective? What do you ever sculpt in orthographic, and what is your take on that?
You know, maybe you will help me to explain. I noticed that recent versions of ZBrush, they very, very have a very dynamic perspective, and when you zoom in, I feel that it's came to orthographic more and more. Mm-hmm. So when you're really, really close, the camera angles change. Do I understand it correctly?
Yeah, so when you get in closer, you'll see there's a little button on the top, the very top of your screen that says AC. And so that is one that will kick on and it'll end up doing kind of like a digital zoom effect. So you have your standard camera, and then if you keep going in closer, ZBrush will never allow you to go through your model. It's one of the things that it won't do. You can't do that. And so when that option kicks in, it kind of turns into like a digital zoom. And that's when you get that kind of parallax effect.
Yeah, and for this reason, I see no reason why to turn off perspective. It works very like conveniently to your needs. You can just, when you scroll back, it's a full perspective like it should be. But when you scroll closer, it's closer to orthographic. So there will be, if I just turn it off now, it's a bit different, but not too much. And if I put it now, it will be a much larger difference. So yeah, I can turn it off in very rare occasions where some technical things that need to do.
And I guess the other key element too for just your workflow in general is that you always, you mentioned you do those like test renders while you're working, as you showed, and that helps you like get your camera angles and your views, and then you can go back in ZBrush, like get another eye on your model.
Yeah. Yeah, and I have no problems like that with that, so it looks similar if I look. Let's check it. So look at this one and ZBrush. So yeah, we can play, I guess here's a more strong perspective. So I may increase in this case and see, try to match it, but I'm not really worried about it too much. Any more questions?
Let's check my list here. And for, yeah, some other questions. What was your polygon count for this model where you're at now? Your total polygon count.
Let's see. It shows 50 millions.
So there you go, 50 million. And then we had some people asking when you're going to do a next battle. You know, you've done the sculpt battles in the past.
Actually, we're in process. I'm now teaching, and we arranged some battle between students. But with my friends, which battles I did, we try to do at least once a year because we're all busy. Like December is close, so we will definitely want to catch up and at least do until the end of the year.
Excellent. All right, back to you.
Yeah. What else I had to say about creatures? So a few other things that inspired Yuki Morita and some old school green monster stuff. And at that day, like monster and girl theme was very common. And I tried to get some inspiration from that. And some animals, but it's more for texturing, but for shapes as well, like put these dots and treat this area. This can be very informative how you treat your surface. And about detail hierarchy, I want to mention the really great example of Anthony Venery Karen, how he treats details in big shapes versus small shapes and how they help each other. So he leads his way with wrinkles. I say it again and again, but I hope it's helpful because you can see my repeated idea in different examples and see that that's really the case. So the small details are following and there's a big shapes that they are supporting. And they're not contradict each other. If they contradict each other, it will be harder to perceive the big shapes. I can try to smooth a little this tentacle and show you how I can divide it into more organic variant. So with, again, daemon standard and lead it, find some breakdowns. And when you do that, you can instantly see, because it's twisting, we can see that the lines that I make made a good lines flowing into each other. So this effect I like. So there's twisting into each other and when you sculpt dragons and creatures like that, it's a very important thing to do this twisting effects. For example, when you do dragon horns, you can even go further and select a part and rotate it across the length, and it will have twisting across the length. So instead of making a simple horse, you do organic shape and you see it as muscles. And then after do some lines like that, which can be a bit of random, it's not necessarily following the particular muscles. When we do creatures like that, it's very fun because you can invent and you can go very far. And after that, I like to go with clay buildup and across this shape, I go and do this cross hatches. It's like what pencil drawers do, and I do it with sculpt. And it helped me to control the shape in a more precise way and push it stronger when I want to the shape to inflate and then goes and shrink my strokes and lead it somewhere else. So this hatches helped me with refining the shape. And then as mentioned, when it's bent, I will do additional folds. So I can use standard with alpha and do. And before doing false, store morph target and try to suggest a few strokes. And make it stronger somewhere, like above, for example, with daemon standard. What I try to avoid is make an even an even line across, and I try to make it stronger at the middle and tone it down a little later. With alphas, what I can do is say I have flipped normal skin alphas for human and creature, and there's a few cool ones. For example, I like this one. I put displace brush and put alpha here and switch to drag direct, and this alpha have a why I like it, because it have a direction also. I will switch to more strong material so we see the details better. And you can have the square. It's a problem that we can fix by hitting surface in alpha settings. You hit surface here and it evening out the levels of depth to the right level. So you have details like that and a lot of stuff going on. And this I try to apply to also not randomly, not parallel like that. It will be boring, but instead I try to hug the big surface with smaller surfaces. Maybe I will want to smooth it like smooth, and it will still be good. It will still something organic going on here, but maybe I will keep it depending on situation. And this one you can do even stronger by some occasional strokes with them standard to break it down.
Now with your alphas, do you create your own alphas?
Sometimes, yes, I have some for creatures, some veins, and like this one is for, sometimes you just need some very crumpled surface for creature. And I still have some square now. But to avoid that as well, I can change focal shift closer to zero, and so it will smooth sides. So sometimes something like that. So I sculpted it on a plane and can apply it, and gives a gross feeling. And fibers like that, but this ones I not very often use because they have this strict nature. Sometimes it's good for in some cases, not but not for these creatures. I would be avoid using this one. But also, I buy a lot of other artist brushes. Pablo Munoz Gomez have a very cool one. Some of them I had have in my startup. This rock brush that I. That's quite universal for me. I can just when something is too squishy and soft, I can add sharpness to it. It can be horns of a dragon, for example. I can go and use that. And this one I like because, again, you can control it and go, give a direction with it.
And that's one of Pablo's brushes?
Yes, this one is a part of a rock pack. Brushes. Also, one of his brush is rock crack. Sometimes you need to have something stronger than them standard, and this is a way to go. And yeah. We have not much time left.
And you've got about 30 minutes or so.
I would want to jump into pipeline, and then we will answer questions more.
Yeah, we've had a lot of people asking about what you do for UVs and retopology. I figured you were going to hit on that at some point.
So there's a few ways you can go regarding to pipeline. I use this, and this, depending on the task. This first two is my work pipeline, and it's used when you do characters for animation. And production pipeline is cinematics and movies, and game dev pipeline is for game engines. There's some common things and some differences between. I highlighted a difference with a yellow color, and you can see that for production, we use UDIMMs. We bake 32-bit displays and map in ZBrush. We use sometimes Substance, sometimes Mari, depending on what you need. And I do test render in either in Iray, it can be inside Substance, or Redshift. It's my way, so it's not the only one, of course. It's a numerous amount of ways you can go. Game dev pipeline, the difference is that you, instead of displacement, you bake normal map and other maps somewhere else in other software, usually. And you test your model in some engine, if the engine is known and ready on your project, you test it there or in Magmaset. But these two ways are quite long, so there was questions about how long do I make a character. And in this way, when I do it for work, it can be a few weeks, it can be month, and it can be more than month, it can be 2 months, and it can be more than 2 months. So it depends on what clients need, how, for example, how close we see character to camera, if it's a cinematic, or how important the character is, or what assets is prepared, already prepared. And maybe we don't need to make a whole character, but we only need to do an armor, for example. So it can may vary a lot, but the pipeline itself is a quite long process, and it have a lot of technical stuff. For personal work, I use, I call this my pipeline. So this is basically all projects that are not supposed to be animated. And in this case, I sculpt in ZBrush as well. I do after topology with ZeriMesher. I do after UVs with UVMaster. For texturing purposes, I bake normal map inside ZBrush and use it later. I use UDIMMs same way as a production pipeline because it's really help to speed up if you make the full pipeline. I do texturing in Substance Painter and render in my and Redshift. And in the end, I render a decimated model. It's I guess it's important point to know that I texturing the first subdivision. So I go everywhere into first subdivision. And this is what I'm going to texture. Sometimes when it's too low poly, I can go further into second subdivision and delete lower and use this for texturing. Sometimes it's better with quality. But rendering, for the rendering, I do another mesh. I go to the highest subdivision. I go to the plugin. Decimation Master, and there I hit a button, keep UVs, and I have my UVs, and decimate my model and render it later. As a result, the mesh that you textured the first subdivision will match your decimation model. It will be the same model, the same UVs, I mean. This pipeline has...
Yes, we had some questions. If you could put that pipeline up on your Gumroad or somewhere so people could see it and potentially download it, and then it's already there.
Yeah. Is so it, if you go to like cover each question that you may have, I describe exactly this pipeline in this tutorial with Kat
Shiba. I'll link that one for you.
Yeah, the first part is more about sculpting animals in an artistic way. And the second part is more about pipeline and going for texturing and render. But this pipeline have downsides and that it's shorter than production pipeline, but it's still long. It still takes time to do these technical things. For example, what you need to do is you need to have each your subtool to have some lowest subdivision. You need to make UVs. To do UVs, I usually split a bit by hand by polygroups. Like this polygroups was for sculpting because it's easy to isolate, but it also for UV mapping. So when you go to UV master, you will hit polygroups and do unwrap, and it will have seams across the where polygroup border is. And it will be a bit more neat if you do that. So it all takes time. So there's quicker ways to do illustrations. That there's a lot of ways. And my second favorite way is ZBrush plus render without UVs, this one that I'm showing. With, you are not supposed to make UVs in this case, and you are not supposed to make any clean, even sphere mesher. You don't need to do that. You just polypaint it inside ZBrush and decimate it, and render whenever you want. You can render it in Marmoset, Arnold, Cycle, Sketchup, and so on. You can go to Gurdjieff scene. ArtStation, he have a tutorial that showing how to pipeline with ZBrush plus Arnold and Maya. So he's showing how to turn on polypaint and make it renderable in Arnold. And another very popular way is just do it only in ZBrush, do everything. So you only use ZBrush and Photoshop. And well-known people who do that is Ralph Gazzetti. And in a previous stream, I guess he talked about it a little, how he combined render passes in ZBrush and combines it in Photoshop. And you can get really cool result as well with using only ZBrush. So yes, there's a lot of ways you can go, and if you have questions about my pipeline, we can go into that, and I can explain some stages that is.
Yeah, so we had some with the posing, and then we had some other ones when you mentioned that you're teaching. They want to know where you are teaching at and how they can get into your classes.
Yeah, so far it's for a studio, so it's not public. But sometimes I try something now for teaching, but it's not much. So I'm preparing for it, and I hope in future I will be teaching more. So far it's Gumroad, the way you can go and get this tutorial.
So you've got about 30 minutes now. So whatever you've had, you know, questions about posing, people do want to kind of see your breakdown with UVs too and stuff. So any of that kind of stuff you want to hit on, it's up to you.
Yeah, I can show how I may, for example. So if you see how much subtools here, it's only 10. So I try to limit the amount of subtool and keep each UV set for each subtool. It's not necessary. You can combine it in several subtool into one, but this way is, I guess, quicker. And when I'm ready and everything is mapped, so you can check if it's mapped and looks good enough to me. So in this case, I didn't do anything additional, just hit unwrap, and I have this result. And when each individual have UV mapping, like that, I go to export, and those export, but not OBG, but instead FBX, and call it for text string. And you will have this window. So before you use the Z plugin, and in a few new version of ZBrush, you can have settings here. And here I hit visible, so it will export all visible subtools. And I don't need maps, but I keep smooth normals, and hit OK. When I export it, I have it in Maya. And there's a list of my meshes. And what I need to do is select each one and put in a neighbor UV set. So I don't worry which one I move where. So what only I need to do is that there each individual have its own UDIM. And then to put it back in ZBrush, I have a little script that what it does for me. So my file is in folder, my Maya file in this folder, and when I run the script, it does exporting for me all OBG files into each individual file. And now with these files, I can go back and import it one by one, just going and selecting TIFF, select TIFF import, and so on and so forth. Why this script is important to me is because when it exports, it creates the right names for each file. So when I import it, it imports with a correct file, so I don't need to replace the file if I export it to generic one. So it's some shortcut for me. I can share the script if you use Maya. That goes with ZBrush pretty well.
Yeah, they're asking if you can throw that up on your Gumroad too.
This script is it's a short one, so I can put it in a file and attach somewhere.
That'd be great. Mm-hmm.
What else about pipeline?
For your posing stuff too, like say if you're not doing a static character like this, and if you have to do one for say a client where it's in a T pose or something like that, do you use the same pipeline with that kind of process?
Well, yeah, except I don't do a pose. Mm-hmm. It's of course it will be quicker because pose takes time, and but I don't worry about that the post takes time, because when you do it twice, when you do both hand twice, say, you practice it more and next time you do it quicker. Mm-hmm. So after the render, as I mentioned, I find one thing I wanted to talk about. I find the problems. So this hair, as I mentioned, is quite blobby and messy. Not this one. This one. And I wanted to fix that, so in the next version. I go to each individual one strand and try to polish it a bit and made a more even look. So if you compare the previous to the next one, you will see the difference, how it's more neat and pleasant than before. And it's a way to go because I see there's still problems that I will cover later. And also that what I noticed on the render actually, and you can see it, judge it for yourself. So in the render, I noticed that her face is quite creepy. And it's easier to make a creepy face when the person is smiling. It's way too easy. And a lot of stuff I didn't like. I didn't like the neck is sagging, and it's not good because when you put your head up, it will be stretching here, and there will be no sagging, so it make her less attractive. And here, in general, too much realistic features, which is fine, and I could push it more and try to achieve more pleasant result. But what instead I did is I decided to simplify it in a more stylized face. And I did the same thing with her body a little bit, especially with the hands. So with a simplified version, and let's see before and after. Before was that and scary stuff. And after it was... more pleasant version. And if we put a bit different material like that, it will be even better.
Now, for the creation of your hair, did you use an IMM brush for that, to create that?
IMM?
Or did you hand sculpt it? Insert mesh brush.
Not really. At first, I had some blob. Then I tried to divide it into strands with Sculptris Pro, like that. And then I started to, at some point, start to split the strands. So at first I splitted this strand and started to treat it as an individual, and this another one. And I go further with splitting, and until I split it into this amount of strands. But this way it helps me, I mean, to control the big shape and have it in mind, have it as a concept. Like, we're concepting not only design of clothing and creatures, but we also concepting the follow of the folds and flow of the hair. It's also a concepting. So help me to stick with it, with the initial shape from the beginning, by dividing it and but keep the big shape. If you check the hands before and after, also was realistic, not finished, and everything was very, very uneven and bad on my test render. And to address that, I again started to think it's more stylized, and start to polish. In each individual finger, it definitely takes time. Mm-hmm. And my advice for fingers in general is, especially for girls, I have fingers here. So I treat it as a narrowing down shape, and the nail is helping with that. So at the base, it's thicker, and then it goes thinner and thinner, and at the tip, it will be very thin, long nail. So maybe it's of course it's not like real hand. We have more things to do in real. But I again try to simplify it. And when I just pinch the tip of a finger, it helps with the general shapes, and from the distance, it looks more appealing. And here I still it's stylized, but I try to keep some shapes and put some wrinkles here because there will be stretching, and I want to show that stretching is happening and support it with wrinkles. and preferences for the smiles. So I was on a realistic site and tried to look at them, at these girls. And then I switched more to the main reference for me was this one, really pretty one. So you can see that in a realistic you have stuff going on here, so stretching of features, and should be really careful with that. It's like realistic, when you do it realistic, it's too easy to get into uncanny valley. And when you do stylized, you can get rid of these unnecessary features and make it more smooth. But you can still have this dimple, even on stylized, this dimple can be quite strong still and looks nice.
You just see the amount of time. Now, when you're doing this stuff too, do you find that taking a break helps you see different things on your model that you may have missed as well, like going back to the things that you may see that are like incorrect or wrong? Do you ever get your eye up?
Especially with portraits, I guess it's the most strong thing that you can feel. With other kind of works as well, taking a break really helps.
And then for another question too, when you're doing, say, creating a model that'll be animated, do you ever use Z Remesher along with polygrouping to help establish clean edges and different loops for that kind of stuff? Or do you manually do the topology?
To remain the topology, can you repeat the question?
Yeah, so let's say you have a client work where you have to do a model that's in a T-pose. Do they usually end up providing you with the base mesh, or do you do your kind of sculpting process and then generate your own base mesh? And if you do that, do you ever use ZRemesher with, say, polygroups to help in getting areas of topology along the joints?
Yeah, usually the client provides base mesh for the body, and quite often it's important for the pipeline, so they have a lot of stuff on this wireframe, the rigging, the blend shapes, and this all can be used several times on different characters, so it's important to keep base mesh the same. If I have to do a topology of the body, let's say from scratch, I will have any base mesh that I had before, previously, and project it into my sculpt. You can also use ZWrap plugin for do that. I can write it down.
Okay.
You can just you can Google it and see how it works. And for faces, it's very, very helpful. And from this base mesh that I previously had, and if I need some, I will need some changes to topology, I just go from there and fixing topology in the ways that I need. Aside from ZBrush, there's another cool plugin that I use, is Ryan Tools. Let me show. So I have this details, but sometimes you, you're happy with the details overall, but you need to make them stronger. And to do that, I have on my shelf the button called Amplify. The button goes with a package with Ryan Tools. And you can get it from the internet. And when I hit the button, it will calculate. Takes some time to calculate. And then I can go and amplify what I have. It really, really helps with printing, especially because they usually want to have more crisp details everywhere, because when you print it, it's the details less visible. These details you will have on a morph target, so if you want to do it everywhere, you can just hit switch, and it will be everything will have more details. I will just do some sculpting.
You've got about 10 minutes or so. And I've been answering the questions as you've been going through them. So everybody's extremely thankful for your knowledge and your time.
You can ask me about interface. I have a lot of cool stuff that I added over the years, and can describe some of it.
For your coloring stuff you do on your models too here, you maybe go cover that process as well, like how do you apply your kind of gradient values and things like that to your sculpts?
So about colors, I think the most interesting subject will be her face. Others is had less my attention so far. With her face, what I can recommend is make quite different values across different parts of the face. It really helps with feeling lively. For polypaint, I usually bake all layers, and so the tips of her nose, the cheeks will be rounder, warmer, and underneath the eyes is lighter, and sometimes I even bring some a bluish color. And put it here. And what I like to observe is some images like that. They have a lot of information and that you can just repeat. And also some makeups. If you go to YouTube and see some beauty bloggers that showing how they do makeup, they may show you a lot of interesting stuff, how they put some shadows under the cheeks. And highlights above the cheeks. So there's a lot of variations that can be. And they highlight sometimes this top part below brows. So you can even follow like real makeup. And when I polypaint, I switch to, may switch to fast shader or skin shade. If I want to go further with painting, I usually use cavity. In masking, mask by cavity. It's like the most common tool when you want to have more details and more variety. And I have this view mask button that allows me to switch in between. So sometimes you don't need to see your mask. It distracts you and you paint, but you don't see a mask, and it's really helpful. When I paint, I also try to put gradients everywhere. Gradients are really helpful with perception. Sometimes it's not in hairs, I'm not sure I want to do that, but maybe try to put some different tone into her top or maybe on the tips. So with a very large mask, do that.
And what matte cap are you using right now? We had some other questions with that too.
And now it's a skin shade. It's a default one.
Just skin shade. Okay.
Yeah, but in the most default one that I use is standard. And in some cases, I just make it brighter and it's still it's already brighter. By default it's 80. So it still can be proper way to polypaint using this material. You can notice that I tried to put blue color in her t-shirt. It's a style, a stylized way to paint when you have only like something that ambient occlusion. You add some bluish tone to it. It can be not blue, it can be greenish, it can be some different of your choice, but it gives some interesting variety and style. And what I do when I paint, I fighting with the sense of dirty colors in any cost. So if it looks dirty to me, I do gradients and things. I can mix the color with things like that, and it may help me with a feel of cleanliness. So for ambient occlusion, you can also do a mask ambient occlusion. Here, mask by AO. We'll put maximum intensity. I can play with distance here. Of course, in a real skirt, we don't, and t-shirt, we don't see this color shadows, but we do some artistic choice to make it more interesting. So I don't treat this pieces like a real one. I don't try to pursue a realistic result in the end. Occlusion can take time, so I usually go backward in subdivisions to do that.
So we got a few more minutes. I think I got most of the questions all answered, and you covered a lot of the stuff already. And then we got one quick one we can probably throw out there. So how do you keep yourself motivated when you're sculpting 8 to 10 hours a day? Like, what makes you come back and sit down and sculpt for another 8 to 10 hours a day?
Well, depend on, I can, you know, these questions that I can answer in very different ways, and they all will be correct. And some of them are like, it's my most hobby that make me excited the most. And it's mixed with my personality and who I see myself. And like, when I do a good job, when I when I achieve something good, that I feel that is good, it makes me more happy. So maybe I'm a bit harsh on myself, and I always want, if I didn't do something for a long time, I mix it with myself that something is bad. So I need to do more stuff. So like, whenever I keep working, it makes me happier. And I think in my life, like, I think the most important is growing and moving forward. And if I live my life and don't see a growth, it's a bad sign. And I always want to keep growing, and it not necessarily in sculpting. It can be something else. But I may switch to something else, but something should be growing in something. And right now it's ZBrush and sculpting.
Yeah, you can definitely, I think it comes down to, you know, passion, and it's what drives you. And you can obviously tell, like, it's, this is what drives you. And I think that's a big thing. You just, you obviously love doing it.
Yeah.
So any other final words of encouragement or wisdom or anything on that end? Because we have a lot of people that they want to be able to do what you do and the quality of your work. And I see a lot of that just in, you know, just the amount of effort you put into what you do. I mean, it's, if you're spending that much time during a day, you're bound to be amazing at it. And so it really shows off through your work.
Yeah, maybe I don't, you know, I think that people think how much I work is more than I actually work. Sometimes I think people think that I work all the time and do nothing else, but it's not true. There's some days
you sleep, right? Yeah, you sleep.
Yeah, and there's days of procrastination that can be weak of it, and it's totally what happens, and can be stretched longer. Yeah, and I guess what's very challenging, and it's what on my list to solve, like we all have a period of time when we're beginning for a few years, like 3, 4, 5 years and more, a very productive period that everybody grows quickly and after work keep working and learning. And at after some point, it tones down, and you have other things in your life. And I really want to have control on that and try to solve this life versus creative fulfillment balance. And I think it's a challenging challenge for many of artists, and there is no answer how to do that. And like everyone is seeking for an answer, and I think there's no one thing that motivates you throughout your whole life. At the beginning, you want to start, you want to get a first job, and you work for that. Later, you want something else. You want better job, for example, better. motivation for a lot of artists I know, they want to have more interesting tasks at work. Because they do props and they want to do characters and they work for that. And I went through this path, and it was different reason for me to work each time. So at first I wanted just work, some work, but then I wanted interesting work that I enjoy through the day. And then I want something else. So it's changing all the time what keeps me motivating.
Yeah, and I think that's definitely I think it's for every single artist we've had on ZBrush Masters, it's that same kind of mentality too. So it's definitely, no one has an answer, as you've mentioned. Just keep doing. Well, thank you all for coming out, and thank you, Maria, for coming out and showing us all your techniques and stuff inside ZBrush. This was excellent. Once again, this was season 4 of ZBrush Masters. So this was the end of season 4. I know we will be doing a season 5. We don't have the lineup for that yet, but that will be coming out as well. This stream will also be on replay on our YouTube channel. And so you can definitely rewatch the entire stream and see all Maria's techniques again, and just stay there being amazed at her talent. So thank you, Maria, for spending the time here with us today.
And thank you, Jolof. It was awesome.
And definitely, you have a following here. If you ever want to do streaming, I'm pretty sure we can get you into the ZBrush Live channel or even your own Twitch channel, and you'd have a bunch of people ready to watch you sculpt. So
we'll think about that.
No pressure. No pressure. All right. Thank you, and take care, everybody, and stay safe. Happy ZBrushing.
Thank you. Bye-bye.